Do this and get better at making melodic techno sound. That is today's video. Let's go do it right now. Hey, I'm Manuel Kitchen and thank you for checking out yet another video. Now, if this is your first time here, don't hesitate to click subscribe, hit that notification bell because you'll be updated whenever I upload a new video. That's only if you click that bell icon as well. You'll be kept in the loop, you won't miss out on anything. Now I'd like to say welcome to my patrons. I mean, obviously it's cool because Patreon is connected to Discord, so there's a lively community talking about different stuff. You can categorize it up into the DIY folks that make stuff. You've got the modular people. Then also you've got like the synth design people, and just people are just like wanting to talk synths and stuff. So it's really cool. It's a fast growing community. Everybody's really nice and you won't be breaking the bank if you want to join up. So you're more than welcome. You'll find a warm home. So come and check it out. As well, I'm working on this mixer that is a hybrid between a club and a studio mixer. COVID is throwing a little bit of dust into the engine because obviously trying to get parts is not the easiest at the moment, but it's working. We're looking at the PCB design, we're looking at the parts, we're looking at the structure, we're looking at the faceplate even. So come and check it out. You can do that at patreon.com/analogkitchen. Links to the equipment noted in the fold below. It means that if you click on the page where it says show more, the page will open and then you'll get all the links. So if you want to find out about the red knobs, you want to find out about the flight case, you want to know what the gear that is that I'm using, you can find it there. Those are affiliate links, mind you, but that's when you can find it. As well as the music. If I like the jam, if it turns out well, then obviously I'm going to throw it on Bandcamp. So that's where you can find the music. Go and check it out. Now I get a lot of questions of people asking me, how do you create sounds that will actually work together? I mean, I've done videos on this. It's not the first time that I'm doing a video on this, but the thing is the question keeps popping up. So I thought to address it again. When it comes to melodic techno, I think we have to go back in time a little bit when it was progressive house music. I do think that those two genres are joined at the hip. I come from the progressive house background. So when I think of one of the first progressive records I can think of, I think it has to do with stuff that was on Gorilla Records back in the days, like maybe Spooky Shmoo, and even before that, Get the Core Passion. Now that was a record that spoke to me in a sense, it has so many different elements within the same song. So I never have heard a record before that covers like three or four genres in itself. Now, the good folks over at Tag Records, which was a record store in London back in the days, flipped the name around, came up with Get Decor, Tag Records obviously, and they made that record called Passion. It's amazing. I think it even went into the charts, but the long sort of like version is a track that's absolutely amazing. Now, it brings me to the point where it had that old school sort of like breakbeat, ravey kind of groove. It had like the really cool, deep sort of like, yeah, progressive house bass line. And that sound is very hot at the moment. Now, with everything that develops over time, it gets diluted a little bit and you take the elements out of it. Like where hip hop was a little bit of rough stuff back in the days, and records in the 80s had bridges and intros and reprises. Mostly now it's just one sort of like groove, one loop, and then people will get into that specific sound. So it's congested of more of a snippet of the things that were going on, which is a cool thing. And you might debate sometimes, it's like, okay, where's the rest of the music? But in the end of the day, when you cut to melodic techno, it is also an element of a certain sound. Now, to get your sounds working means you have to really pinpoint what sounds work at what specific point. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to just like get two different sounds to work together, and that should make up your groove. Anything else that goes on top of that should really be an addition to it. But this needs to be the groove, and that needs to be like the foundation on which you build the rest of the groove. Now, let's see if we can make it work. If you're ready, let's go and check it out. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome to the live set. I've got this flight case that I filled up with some goodies. The Akai MPC Live as the bleeding heart of the operation that is joined at the hip with the Octatrack. So if I switch a pattern here or I chase program change here, I'll do it also on the Octatrack. The Octatrack will switch in time. Now, how I do it is like you go in on your Octatrack, you press function and project, then you'll go to the MIDI page, and on the MIDI page you'll go to, yes, you'll navigate to control. You look at control, and then you make sure that the audio channel CC is on in. Audio CC out, internal, external, just leave that on. Audio note in is on, is also checked. And then I'll get out of there. Then I'll go to the next page on the MIDI page, and that's sync. Now on sync, the MIDI sync, program change, receive needs to be on, clock receive needs to be on. And what I've also done is on the channels, which is the next page down, the auto channel for the whole Octatrack is 9, because on that page you'll see that the Octatrack internal memory has got channels 1 through 8 allocated for stuff that the Octatrack needs to do. I think it works together with other Electron gear, so I don't want to tamper with that. So my next channel up for this thing to respond to is channel 9. Now on the Akai MPC Live, I've got channel 9 also set up as the channel that's sending program changes over to the Akai Octatrack, and then I just utilize the channel, the track on the Akai MPC Live as I would any other track. So on track 1 is a kick, on track 2 is an open hat, track 3 is my close hat, track 4 is my snare. I'm just gonna make my beat with that. So that's just basically the drum computer setup. For this beat today though, I didn't really go overboard, as the track is a little bit more Italo, a cross between melodic techno and Italo house. So I don't want my drums to be over populated. So basically this all that you heard, that's definitely what the drums are going to be. Now, the Tetra's over here, multi-clock's over here. I've got Audio Things Micro Monster, the Model D, which is going to be playing my Italo bass line. I've got a mini tower over here, and then you're listening to the almighty TB-03. Now, do we have a bass drum? Yes, we have. Let's play that. Nice. Now, the thing that I was saying, like, when I go to my track channel 9, that I've selected for my Octatrack. So, I mean, it's basically like tracks on a door. You just stack them all together in the Octatrack. You just make a sequence, and within that sequence, you can create songs. So the sequences are patterns, and within those patterns, you can allocate different destinations for the different machines that you're using. So it can eat MIDI, it can eat audio, as you're hearing to, or you're listening to audio right now. Now, as I said, I've got my trusty Novation Launch Control XL sitting here underneath the Arturia Analog Factory, my MIDI keyboard. And I've mapped out the drums and I've mapped out some filters. So that means that I don't have to menu dive within the Akai MPC Live to just like turn stuff on and off, because obviously that's not what you want. Menu diving, bleh, no, let's not do it. The MIDI tower, got my L12 live track zoom mixer over here. Yeah, that's pretty much what we're going to be working with today. Now, out of the Akai MPC Live, there's multiple channels coming. I'm using the stereo output for all the drums and track 6, channel 6. I just randomly chose that channel, but channel 6, the output 6 is the kick. So my kick is always on a separate channel so that I can control it better. If I'm in a club or I'm in a venue or wherever, you need to be in control of what happens with the kick. Very important. Okay, now let's see if we can add some more drums. 2 and 3, mute. Nice. Right. Now the trick is also not to go in and overly mix or compress or to do anything. I'll just level it up. I try to just like level it as close to what I can get, so that I don't have to start worrying about the sound when I'm performing. That's something that I don't want at all. Now, when it comes to making sounds for melodic techno, let's just turn this down a little bit more. Nice, see? This is why I love the, that's why I love my Launch Control XL. So let's just go in a little bit more hypnotic. Just the hats. Now, when it comes to making sounds for melodic techno, the SH-101 is like one of the best synthesizers you can use to get all these blocky, short sounds going. On its own though, it doesn't really, well, it sounds amazing, but it's not too, well, I think it could, you can spice it up by using an effect pedal maybe. So what I've done is I've stuck it into the Space Echo, the RE20, and then, you know, when you play something, open up a little bit more of that. Nice. Now the sound is not that complicated. I've got the sub oscillator open completely. Back off of and then let's open up the frequency a little bit more for the filter. Nice. Now, I like to use short sounds. So my ADSR is pretty much, you know, the attack is there. I'm kicking the camera. The attack is there. I've got my, do you see it? Let me just slowly, there you go. So the attack is all the way on the bottom, then the decay is like maybe like on 3 when you're counting the lines is on 3, then the sustain is on 2 and 2.5, and the release also. So you get a so when you open this up. Really nice, I really love it. So what we also can do, because the multi-clock over here on track 1, it sends out a trigger signal. Now what is nice to do with this thing is to trigger it so that it will play an arpeggio, because arpeggios are always cool. I've got one on the octatrack hidden away on track 1, which plays something like this. Loud side, so let's go in. But also this sound, this is something that needs to be an accompanying sound. So if we categorize our track into the ABC category that you hear me speaking about, the A category is this. Everything that you're hearing right now is my A category groove. I mean, I can dance to this, yeah? In one way, one form or another. This in itself I can dance to, yeah? Hi-hats. Can hear this is something that's interesting already to dance to, right? Cool. Then the B segment is stuff that needs to be there to dress up your track, but you know, it shouldn't dominate the track, because this will kill you in the end. So I'll go in and I'll stick it in a place. I'll stick it in a, what's happening? What I will do is I will go in, edit the sample, turn down the volume a little bit. And sometimes you need to search for accents on the sound. So you can hear the ba, do, 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 ba, do, ba. So I want to focus more on the higher note, because if more music starts to play, that's the one that's going to stand out. And that's, when you hear that, that's probably what people are going to latch on to. So when you create an infinite loop on your arpeggio, that's what you should need to look for. Something that goes back like, so this now creates some sort of a vibe that people can latch on to, they keep dancing to it, but it's not really drawing their attention away from the groove, right? Now, to master that even more, I took my little playing to Tibet and I asked the monks to go stand next to my microphone. Well, not, but I got a sample that the which is really nice in order to get a lot of atmosphere in this track going. They got a kick, 1, 2, and the monks go. Yeah, nice. This I stick far away in the music because as the same as the arpeggio, it's not something that should be there as a lead vocalist. So this also goes in the B category of my track. So same thing here, go to track 2. Lower it a little bit. And now there's something that I would classify as a B segment if I'm playing it now, but it could be an A segment as well. And I'll explain that. So if I turn those three off, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, go. So now we're back to where we were, yeah? Let's lower the TB-03. Stick it somewhere where it's just more of a blanket. And listen to this sample. And the thing what I do is I want my layers to go up and down. So when you create sounds, especially for this type of music, you should really focus on, okay, where do I want my track to go? I can think like, okay, you know what? I'll start my track like this. Kick and snare. Now it's a completely different track. You understand what I mean? So I'll take the snare out, take the head out, and go in a little bit more hypnotic, like this. See, this is a completely different vibe. So now you can change your sound around within the same pattern. You can have it be a little bit more aggressive, have it be a little bit more adrenaline, but at the same time also keep people there where they need to go. And mind you, this is not even the bass line that I'm going to be playing with, because my bass line is something else. Because as I said, a little bit of an Italo vibe, so I've got an arpeggiated bass line as well, which plays something like this. Now we go, Italo. Now you see how those different sounds work together and build the track into one thing. Let's go in for the monks. Let's go back to Tibet. Nice. Now I turn this off because I want to play something here. Let's put a little bit more delay on there. What if we would play something of an arpeggio? That would be nice. It would be nice if we can accompany our bass line that's playing and have that play the same thing. So I'll go to low and I'll play. If I'm not mistaken, oh nice. And now that I have this sitting on top of that, let's make sure that we shorten those notes again. Okay, monks off, sound on. Do you feel how this now has lifted to another level? Now what I've also done is I've played some chords And those scores are going to be played by the Dave Smith, the Tetra over here. Very nice. It sounds a bit like the old Overheim / Jupiter sounds. So I'll go in. I'll land on the track because I've got a filter also mapped on the Logitech XL. Because the Tetra gets MIDI from the Akai MPC Live, I can also map out the MIDI CCs for the filters and for the resonance and stuff. So let's see what is playing. They got a kick. 1, 2, 3, air. Woo! Little bit of reverb. I think the reverb might be a little bit too hot. Let's go in. Lower the filter. Turn this off. Do you hear that the TB-03 that I sneakily just up 12 notes? Let's turn it off and see that you're missing. Here we go. See? Gone. Ah. What we need is 1, 2, 3, go back in. Filter down, baseline in, here we go. So that's the Dave Smith off. That's the MPC, that's the Model D on again. Nice. Now what else can we utilize? Can we just like see if we can, and this is what I like about the SH-101. If I turn the sequencer off, I can still play stuff. Obviously if I turn it on. Again, a little bit more delay. I love it because this thing can do bass, it can do high notes, it can do leads. You want to make play leads. Some noise on it. Oh, nice. So this thing is a very handy tool to use. Turn off this sound here. And I really like the fact that you can just do so many different things with it. Let's turn off my beats. Nice. So that's what I said. So on the multi-clock now, this is something I didn't explain. I've got the four different MIDI streams that I can send. So on channel 2, it's my TB-03. On track 1, it is this bad boy, so I'll put it on play. Nice. And the thing that the way I set it up is that because I've only got my two hands to work with, so I want to do stuff that handles itself a little bit so I can move on to something else. So when the space echo is taking care of this sound being washed out a little bit, I can now see if I can move somewhere else. Turn the drums off, all of them, and just enter the kick in. And then both of them will start, you know? Not that one starts and have to start, stop. I'd really hate that I have to start the Akai, go to a different pattern, start the Octatrack. No, I want those things to just work. So in the internal memory of the Octatrack as well, if I switch to a different pattern, internally with the MIDI parts, different things will play. Let's play more drums. And I think it's very important to also note that you should never be in a hurry. You should just look at, okay, what is important? What do I need to hear? If you're hearing it, do you need to hear it? Yes or no, you know? I mean, this sound is cool. I think it's washed out a little bit. And the RE20's got a nice reverb on it, but I mean the delay, I mean, I hardly ever use the reverb. I've got the Hall of Fame coming from different outputs of the Akai as well. So, I mean, the fact that I like, what I like about this way of working is that you can actually just like go in, think on, you know, what is it that I want to bring? Sometimes I'll bring a distortion pedal, and other times I will just bring my Hall of Fame. You know, it just depends. It's like a band, you know, you keep changing stuff up and nothing should be set in stone. Now, I can do a lot of stuff with a lot of sounds, but for now I just opted to go for this. There's vocal samples that I have also. Believe it or not, I sang myself. Now on the vocal page, I think it says, who is paying attention? Who knows where this vocal is coming from? Now I can utilize that, and obviously I can stick a microphone in and sing it myself. So now that I've got a nice breakdown, let's see if we can start a beat. 1, 2, 3, and. So basically, you don't really have to, it doesn't need to be rocket science. You just need to think ahead, like, okay, what is it that I want to do? So, and this is just a workflow that I think as a hybrid producer, I think I make the best of both worlds. So I like to prepare the sounds beforehand with the synths, obviously. So I will sample this, go back to the computer, work it there. And then when I get to this point, this is performance for me. This is performance hands-on, not like standing there and just utilizing things, because there's a limitation in what you can bring, what you can do. And in this sense, I think that this is the best way to work it. Now the track, as I said, is heavily built on the sounds. It's heavily built on the sounds in a way that I can rely on the sounds being thick and round enough. Now, if you were interested, I will do a future video on where those magical frequencies lie, what to look for, how those sounds work, because I don't mix, master, or EQ or compress anything on those sounds. Every sound that you're hearing out of this live set is absolutely raw. Yeah, this is, it comes as is. There's no EQ on my Model D, there's no EQ on the TB-03, because I do believe, and it takes a bit of practice, but after a while, you'll just... I mean, it starts with cool drums, obviously, you know, you have to just like make sure that your drums are working. I mean, you can debate that the highest are loud, I like my highest loud, this is a little bit too loud, but you know what, you get to a venue, you see what happens, or when you got nice monitor speakers and the room tech is standing there, who'll tell you, yo dude, turn down the hats, okay, you'll just go in and you'll go like, oh, you know what, yeah, let's turn down the hats, or turn down the kick, all right, turn down the kick, it's that simple. From the minute you start to just like put one sound in there, and I always go for the fattest sound with the most transients on it, because then I know, oh my god, I can build everything around it. In this case, the Model D. It's nice because it's got very, very short envelopes as well. Now let's play the 101 again. And then you can have a song, and then to both those analog sound sources. Now, the nice character of the analog sound is that it's rich, it fills a space, and that void is very rudimentary. You'll hear it when it works. You will also hear it when it doesn't work. So you won't be lingering on if it doesn't work. You know, you just move on and get away from there. And the trick is variation. So another analog source. Which obviously is the Tetra. And it's that simple. Going in and using the volume knobs as a level lets you just level everything out. And now I can enter just those extra samples here. And now you understand why this is a B category sound. It doesn't take over. You need the Tetra, you need the Model D. You don't need this arpeggio, but it's nice that it's there. And then the monks are pretty much there for Ear Candy. And if I want to go back out, function, hit 1, 2, 3, and 4, and then we go to something else. This is a switch. I'm in the same pattern. And still the track is going somewhere else. Nice. Turn this off. Subscribe if you haven't done so already, and if you made it this far into the video, you are an absolute superstar. Thank you for checking that out. Now, also try out my Patreon pages where you can get more in depth and ask me more about the topics that are just like the surfacing in those videos. Sometimes I do get that stuff might go a little bit too fast. Obviously, you can go over to my Patreon page, ask me stuff. And also there's a community that I've got connected by connecting Discord to Patreon, which means that's more of us. That's more people, so if you've got more questions than answers, that might be your place. You'll find a warm home and you'll find a lot of knowledge and information. So that's a cool thing to do. You won't be breaking the bank. Go and check that out. As well as the tracks, you can find them on Bandcamp. If I like the jams, that's up for debate sometimes. If I like the jams, then I'll stick them on my Bandcamp page. But there's some cool music out there as well. So go and check it out. And yeah, now thanks for watching, and I'll catch you next week on another video. Peace.